Welcome to the Rock Church and World Outreach Center. We pray that this message will strengthen and encourage you. Now, here's a message from Pastor Dan Roth.
One last thing that I want to mention, and as I do, some neat things are taking place here in the structure and organization of the Rock Church and World Outreach Center. And I'm going to ask and invite Pastor Jim Cobray, as well as Pastor Luke and his wife Stacy to come, and my wife Pastor Jessica to come to the platform. And let's hear what's going on here at the Rock.
Well,
Pastor Jim.
There's all kinds of cool changes that are taking place. Everybody knows this. I've already announced it in all the services except this one. And so you all are prepared for this. And one of the things I wanted to share with you, so we can pray over Pastor Dan and Pastor Luke, is that they are getting a promotion. You know, before, Pastor Dan was the executive pastor, and now Pastor Luke is going to be the executive pastor. And Pastor Dan is going into the maintenance department. And I'm just kidding with you. No, he's going to be the maintenance part back there saying, yay. He's going to be the new senior pastor of the church. And so it's just, a good, healthy church prepares for this time. It doesn't wait with an egotistical leader of gray hair that waits and holds on and holds on and holds on and holds on. And then finally, nobody's in the church but a few gray-haired people and that relate with that particular person, but prepares for this day. And Debbie was here last service. She's now taken on a new ministry at this particular time where she had to run to. It's called babysitting. And so she sends her love, and she's great and wonderful. So last service, she was here. And I just wanted to share with you, so Pastor Dan's going to be the lead pastor, Pastor Luke. They're already operating in this, and this is just so that we can continue in organization for the next generation, preparing for the generation after that, and the generation after that, and after that, so that we stay a healthy church all the time. For those of you that have questions, what is Pastor Deborah and I going to do? We have a new assignment and a new title. We're called Happy Pastors. And no longer is the weight of the church on me. And I have passed that on to Dan and Luke. And we're going to still be here. We're going to, like I ministered last Wednesday night. If you weren't here, you missed it. It was really good. And so, and then Deborah will be ministering not this coming Sunday night, but a week from Sunday night on the millennium period of eschatology. And so we're going to continue doing Bible college and things like that. So we're not going anywhere because we're in love with you. And it's hard to go to another church when you're in love with this church. You know, I mean, it's just our home. And so unless you kick us out, but we will be gone for a little bit every now and then. I'd like to spend some time with Mama. I don't know what I'm going to do with it now that I'm old, but I'd like to spend some time with Mama, and it's a healthy place. In order for us to stay healthy, I would like you to welcome your new lead pastors. and can I say, I have just all the admiration in the world for these pastors. I don't care where you go. You go to a conference in New York City that's advertised as the greatest conference, or fly to Australia or wherever you want to go to a conference. You will not hear the word of God any better than what they bring you. They are amazing. So it is wonderful. So those of you that are here, let's pray over them. Is that all right? And so stand to your feet, everybody. Put your hands like this. Put a hand out like this towards them. And let's pray. And let's just bless them. Father, in the name of Jesus, we bring this before you, this transition time in this period. Ask that you would bless them, Father, from the top of their head to the bottom of their feet. We thank you, God, for a mighty move of your Spirit in this place and in their hearts and in their lives as they develop the church, but more importantly, Lord, they develop a relationship towards you and their family and the church, and all is remains incredibly healthy. Bless them. You've already anointed them, Lord. We thank you for continued oneness and love and faith in this midst. In Jesus' name, we're all in agreement, and we say amen. Love you guys.
God is so good. You guys can have a seat. And since I got the mic, I get to say some things. First off, Pastor Luke will be ministering tonight, so I'm sure he'll have some comments. He's going to go study right now. But I just want to mention, Pastor Deborah mentioned it during the first service, that church is titled three things in the Word of God. First of all, you'll find that we are a family. We're all bound together by blood. It's not black or white or brown or any other color or anything like that. Now it's the blood of Jesus that binds us together. We're all brothers and sisters in the Lord. Secondly, we're called a house. We understand that a house is known by what it produces, the children that run out of the house, and we have a reputation here in the community as well as around the world. Maybe some of you guys don't know, but people all over the world look to this place to find out how to do church, how to do outreaches, what are you guys doing with discipleship, and they look to us, and we have a reputation that goes out. But I'd like to focus on the last part of that, which is that we are a body. And basically, that's all we're doing is that we're defining the functions of the body here at the Rock Church and World Outreach Center. Title is not important. Function is what's important, you know, and that's where we need each other. And I so value and so appreciate the giftings that are on Pastor Luke Cobray's life, his wife Stacy. They're both dynamic people, and they have giftings that I don't have, and I so appreciate the fact that they encourage me to be better as well, you know, that I can champion them and encourage them in what God has called them to do here in the body of Christ. I think some neat things are going to take place. Pastor Luke's going to get in some areas and really develop some things in the coming weeks and months and even into the next year. As well, Pastor Jessica, my wonderful wife, who has a heart and a passion for women's ministry here at The Rock. She's already doing that and doing a phenomenal job. And then additionally, she's overseeing the outreach, and we do have outreach directors and departments and all that kind of stuff, but her heart is continually pushing us. Let's get the people involved. Let's get everyone together, and let's do this as one man, and let's reach out into the Inland Empire and developing that heart in us. But I do want to give honor where honor is due, and I want to say thank you to Pastors Jim and Pastor Deborah Cobray, who have loved us, who have sacrificed, and who have given over the decades. And I just so appreciate the platform that they have built and that foundation, which is Jesus Christ. And now, as the next generation coming and taking hold of this, that we can go higher because of the sacrifices. We can go farther. We can go faster because they developed. They were that tip of the arrow that pierced through. They were breakthrough people. And now here comes the shaft and the feathers going farther and propelling what God had already started into the future. It is neat days ahead of us, you guys. Some things about The Rock are not going to change. We're still endeavoring to have a church that doesn't know the name of the senior pastor but knows the name of Jesus. That doesn't change. Okay? Doesn't matter who's in the pulpit. It's about Jesus. As well, we're loving people to life. The Inland Empire shall be saved. None of that changes, you guys. This is still the Rock Church and World Outreach Center. Now, some of the expressions of that in the seven pillars, whether it be altar calls, discipleship, good works, world missions, leadership training, whatever it is that we're doing, church plants, you know, they may not look like they looked in the past, and that's okay, because we're going to move forward and reach a generation for Jesus, and some neat things are going to be ahead of us, and so I'm excited. Are you guys excited about the future? I believe our best days are ahead of us. And Pastor Jim, if I could say, I believe that God has a special assignment. I know right now you're the happy pastor, and you get to do some fun stuff, but I believe that God has a season ahead of you that will just blow us all away of fruitfulness and effectiveness. And I just feel like God is just wanting to tell you, be encouraged. Take a breath, take a rest, but get ready because some neat things are ahead of you. Love you, Pastor. You're awesome. Isn't God good? All right. Well, I'm not going to make you stand. You guys have been up, down, you know, so we'll just let you guys sit. We're going to pray, and we're going to invite the Holy Spirit to teach us. Carrie, would you come grab this? All right, now we got the formalities out of the way. Let me lose the jacket here. Give that to my wife. She's cold, all right? And let's pray together. Get your Bibles, get your electronic device, whatever you brought with you to church so you can follow along, take some notes. If you don't have your Bibles or anything like that, we'll put the scriptures up for you on the overheads. That way we can all follow together. But let's put our hearts before the Lord and go together in prayer before the Lord. Father, we come to you in the mighty name of Jesus. And Lord, we're so grateful that God, you are the one who puts order in the church, God. And this is your church. This is your house. This is your family. This is your body, God. And so I thank you, God, that we together in unity and love can function and move forward, God, reaching the Inland Empire as well as around the world. God, we're so grateful to be in this place at this time. Now, God, as we open up the word of the Lord together, God, we pray that you open it up to us. Open our eyes to see, our ears to hear, our hearts to have a good understanding. May we be the good ground where the word is sown. May it produce something in each and every one of our individual lives. Lord God, we acknowledge that it's not a man or a woman, not the young or the old, not the black, the white, the brown, any other color we could imagine. This is about us coming together and hearing from you. Holy Spirit, you are the true teacher of the church. So welcome in this place, Holy Spirit. Be our teacher, be our guide. Give us the vision, the wisdom, the instruction, the direction, even the correction we need for our lives. Lord, motivate us and cause us to become all that you would call us to be, Lord, and do what you've called us to do. Lord, we give you the praise and the glory and the honor for it. God, we don't just ask this blessing upon ourselves, also we'd ask it for all the churches, both here in the Inland Empire as well as around the planet, God. They're our brothers and sisters, and at no time do we think ourselves any better than anybody else. We see ourselves as co-laborers and workers together in your field, building one kingdom, and that's yours, God. So we ask, God, that you bless all of our brothers and sisters, bless the Baptists, Lutherans, Methodists, Episcopalians, Charismatics, Pentecostals, God. Thank you, Lord, for Calvary Chapel, for Harvest, for The Way, for Ecclesia and Trinity and Emmanuel Baptist, God, for our Catholic brothers and sisters and Adventist brothers and sisters, for the assemblies and the four square denominations, God, for Victory and Crossroads, all the great churches that are out there, Lord. If they're preaching your gospel, preaching your truth, Lord, bless them as you would bless us, God. And Father, we don't forget our persecuted brothers and sisters, God. We would ask, Lord, that you watch over them, protect them, bless them, encourage them, strengthen them, guard them, God. May they endure to the end. May they be delivered, God. In Jesus' mighty name, we're all in agreement. We say, amen. Amen. Today, get your Bibles out and go with me to Hebrews. Once again, the 11th chapter. We've been in a series called Homeland. And this is part number 5. We're wrapping up the series today. Now, don't worry if it's your first time with us and you're saying, well, wait a second, I'm going to be lost. No, today's message stands on its own. And also, we will review some of the concepts and some of the things that we've talked about leading up to this point. Hebrews, the 11th chapter, we started in verse number 13. And it says these words in Hebrews chapter 11. Verse number 13, it says this. It says, these all died in faith, not having received the promises, but having seen them afar off, were assured of them, embraced them, and confessed that they were strangers and pilgrims on the earth. And when we started this series, if you remember, we talked about how we are no longer looking for things here on the earth, but we see the invisible. We see something that's unseen. And because of that now, we have to start off being assured of them, that we have to cross over, that it has to be 100%. We are no longer attached to the things of this world. Because of that, we embrace them, we draw them near, and we don't let them go. And finally, we confess them, which brought us to the second part, that we are strangers and pilgrims. You remember Pastor Jim taught us about that, how to choose the right homeland. And he ended with this, that we are to be imitators of Christ. So then in part number 3, verse number 14, it says, for those who say such things declare plainly that they seek a homeland. Pastor Luke talked to us about declaring plainly with our lives that when we know who we are, that we will know what it is that we're supposed to do. And last week when we were together, part number 4, Pastor Luke brought a brilliant message about pioneering. Verse 15, and truly if they had called to mind that country from which they had come out, they would have had opportunity to return. And you remember, we learned about being a pioneer, that we're leaving the place where we were at and that we're starting something new, that we're going into new areas, new arenas in life. And not even opposition can stop us now. Now we look at opposition as opportunity. That it doesn't matter how old you are, doesn't matter your education level, doesn't matter any of that kind of stuff. What matters is that you are seeking a homeland, that you've got God in your sights, and now you are launching out into something an amazing, wonderful, awesome adventure with God. Which brings us to today's message, part number 5. It says, but now they desire a better. Everybody say better.
Better.
Oh, come on. That was about half of you guys. Say it loud. Everybody say better.
Better.
There you are. He says, they desire a better. That is a heavenly country. Therefore, God is not ashamed to be called their God, for he has prepared a city for them. Today, I want to talk to you about these words, desiring better. See, life here on earth is good. Don't get me wrong. There are definitely things that happen here on the earth that we could say, man, that's fun, that's good. And yet, as good as life can get here on the earth, we as Christians, with that invisible sight, that faith vision, now see something that's greater than what we see here on the earth. And therefore, our desire is not set on the things of this earth. No, now we desire better. That is the heavenly. Jay Quarles said this. He said, heaven is better than earth because there is light without darkness, joy without grief, desire without punishment, love without sadness, safety without fear, health without disease, and life without death. Now, I want you to notice all those things that I just lifted, we have here on the earth. We've got safety, but there's always that wonder, there's always that fear that comes and says, well, are you really safe? We have joy, and yet there's griefs that come throughout our lives. We have light, and yet darkness is ever present. But I'm here to tell you today that there's something going to happen when we cross over, when finally we get to come to the homeland, when we start to enter into the gates, and now there is light without darkness. It's a different realm. Now where there's joy without griefs, now where there is health without sickness. See, we're going to cross over into something that is amazing. Eye has not seen, ear has not heard the things that God has prepared for those who love him. And yet he has revealed them to us by his Spirit, says the Lord. And so we get a picture of that here on the earth. And while those things may be present on the opposite end, did you know that as Christians, we can have joy no matter what the circumstances? See, because our joy as Christians is not based on worldly circumstances. See, the world, they go to Disneyland, they have the happiest place on earth, right? Okay, that's fine. If your happiness is based on sitting in a line waiting for a ride and kids are screaming at you, pulling at your leg, Daddy, I want some popcorn. Oh my goodness, somebody get me out of here, right? And I'll give that to them. Okay, happiest place on earth, manufactured experiences. But our joy is not based on a manufactured experience. Our joy is based on the fact that Jesus is alive, that he's seated at the right hand of God, and that he has prepared a place for me, and I go to him to be with him forever. See, we can have joy despite any circumstances. Now, don't get me wrong. There's going to be times. There is a time and a season for everything here on the earth where we will have sadness. We will have sorrows. There will be griefs that we have to endure. And it's good for us to go through those processes. And yet there will come a day when he will wipe every tear from our eyes and we will sorrow no more because we will ever be with him. Desiring better. A couple of things that have to happen in our lives if we're going to desire better. Now, before you can have a desire, there has to be something. One word, it's called a delight. In fact, I'm going to make a statement and put it up on the overheads for you. Our delight determines our desires. Think about that for a second. Our delight determines our desires. Let's say that, I'm not a sports guy, okay? I don't watch sports. I'm not really into that. Okay, I used to be when I was a kid, got baseball cards and basketball cards and all that kind of stuff, knew the team names and the players and all that kind of stuff. Now I couldn't even tell you. There's teams coming up. I'm like, is that an A team, double A team? What is that, you know? I don't even know anymore. And so let's say I went and went out to a basketball game and had a great experience. Man, we were standing to our feet cheering on the team. People around me were screaming, and afterwards they shot the winning goal and people were hugging on each other. Man, we're having a good time. There's that camaraderie. And afterwards I found, man, I really had fun. I delighted myself in that time. You know what would happen? My delight would start to change my desires. Maybe I would desire to go out and get a jersey. I'd go down to Sports Authority or one of the sports stores and start to get the gear, right? I'd get the hat with the team logo on it. Maybe afterwards I would desire to get season tickets so that I could be there for all the action, right? I want to just be involved in it. I'm going to get the hot dog and the big soda and all that kind of stuff. And so my desires would start to change. Maybe I would even start to look at, you know, this is so cool. Maybe I'll get involved in like a fantasy league online and start picking the players and looking at their stats and following who's winning and looking to see who's going to win the big game. See, our delight determines our desires. Like the surfer who caught their first wave and now all of a sudden they can't think about anything else but heading out to the ocean. Like the businessman or woman who started something out of their garage and it was their passion, but they got a taste of making money for the first time and someone else appreciated their product and now all of a sudden they're thinking about, man, I love that feeling, I love that rush, and they start to desire to build their business and create things. Now for the Christian, when we're seeking a homeland, where is our delight supposed to be? Where does that start? I'm glad you asked the question. Take a look with me in the book of Psalms, if you will. Okay, turn in your Bibles to the book of Psalms or thumb over, whatever you're doing, all right? Those of you that have your electronic devices know what I mean. I don't think I know what I mean, but that's okay. Psalm 37. Great verse in Psalm 37, verse number 4. Take a look at it with me together. Psalm 37, verse 4 says this. It says, delight yourself also. Where? Oh, come on. That was like a quarter of you guys. Okay. Now the rest of you all caught back up with us. Okay, let's all say it together. Delight yourself also where? In the Lord. Now look at this. Our delight is to be in the Lord. And as we delight ourselves in the Lord, now all of a sudden our desire will be there. Look at what the rest of the verse says. And he shall give you the desires of your heart. Billy Graham said that your delight will alter your desire. Anybody ever had the experience after they became a Christian where you went to go and do something you used to do before you got saved and you just found no pleasure in it? All of a sudden, you were just ruined for the world, right? There's no going back. When you have met up with Jesus, there is no accolades, no fame, no fortune, no wealth, no rush, no high. Nothing compares to the presence and the power of God in your life. Now think about that. What happened? Used to be you could go down to the club and you could get your groove on, right? But now that you're a Christian, you think about the club and you go, man, I just don't even want to be around those people. I don't want to be around that stuff. Used to be that you could go hang out with the brothers of Stand and Lean Incorporated, right? Standing on a corner, leaning on a wall. You remember those guys? But now, I can't be around them anymore. Those guys drag me down. I want to hang out with Jesus. Why? Because your delight determines your desire. When you delight yourself in the Lord, now all of a sudden your desires change. I don't want that stuff anymore. I don't want the high anymore. I don't want the wealth anymore. No, I want Jesus. I want to be in church. I want to be in the Word. I want to be in prayer. I want to be out there in the world getting people saved. Now I have a new desire. Your delight determines your desires. Let's take a look at it together in 1 John chapter 2. How's this work? 1 John chapter 2. Let me show it with you. 1 John chapter 2. If you're starting the book of Revelation, just go back a couple books. And you'll find 1 John. 1 John chapter 2. We're going to take a look at three verses and see how this works. Verse number 15 through verse number 17. Says this, 1 John chapter 2, starting in verse number 15, says this, do not love the world or the things in the world. Now notice what he says, do not love. That love, really you could, if you wanted to, for our understanding today, put the word delight. Do not delight yourself in. Do not love the world, nor the things in this world. Why? Because what you delight yourself in determines your desire. So if you love the world, if you delight yourself in the world, then you will desire worldly things. If anyone loves the world, the love of the Father is not in him. Now notice that. Why? Because your desires aren't for God anymore. Your desires are for the things of this earth. So he says, do not love the world nor the things in the world, because if you love the world, your desires will be after it, and the love of the Father is not in you. Now let's read on. Verse 16, for all that is in the world, the lust of the flesh, the lust of the eyes, and the pride of life is not of the Father, but is of the world. See, when you start to delight yourself in the world, then your desire, notice it says the lust of the flesh, the lust of the eyes, and the pride of life. See, your desires will start to turn away from God as you delight yourself in the world, and they will turn towards natural, physical things that the flesh lusts after, that the eye lusts after, and that you will now start to turn selfish into pride. Start exalting yourself. And it says that that is not of the Father, but it is of the world. Verse 17, and the world is passing away, and the lust of it. Now notice, these things are temporary. These things are not to be held on to. They're to be stewarded and used. So don't let those things get a hold of you. You have hold of them. You use them wisely, but those are not your desire. See, God is not opposed to us having things or enjoying things here on the earth. He's given us richly all things to enjoy, the Bible says. And yet, that's not my desire. Why? Because I don't delight in those things. I don't care money, no money. I don't care fame, fortune, no fame, fortune. I don't care accolades or any of that kind. I don't care. I don't need a pat on the back. I need a well done, good and faithful servant from God the Father. Are you listening? And all that stuff on the earth is passing away. Can I say it to you like this? It's all dirt. It all came up out of the ground. We made it out of the resources we had here on the earth, and it's all gonna burn. That's what your Bible says, isn't it? That there's gonna come a day where Jesus comes back and the earth will be melted with fervent heat and all the things in it will be destroyed. So listen, while you're here, use the dirt wisely, okay? But realize, it's just dirt. Doesn't matter how much I have, how little I have. God doesn't need that stuff. God does not need money. Come on, somebody. He didn't purchase you with a price, gold or silver. No, it was the blood of Jesus that paid your redemption. So those things are passing away, and the lust thereof, or the lust of it. Now look at the rest of the verse. But he who does the will of God abides forever. You know that word abide means live, stay, and dwell. We get to be with God forever and ever. We have a homeland that we get to be with God. But we know that we're going to live, stay, and dwell forever when we do the will of God, when our desire is to be pleasing to him. And because we delight in the Lord, now our desires are shifting. Our desires have changed to the things of God. And now we know that we abide forever. We get to live with God. Which brings us to the second thing is this. If we're going to desire better, number one, our delight determines our desires. But second thing is this. Our desire determines our destination. Our desire determines our destination, just like Pastor Luke taught us a couple of weeks ago. When you know who you are, you will know what to do. So as you delight yourself in the Lord, it will start to change your desires, and now your desires will determine your direction. In other words, you will see, this is what I need to do. This is where I need to go. This is what I need to be. This is what God has in store for my life. Otherwise, you will be aimless. Remember Alice in Wonderland? You guys remember that story, the children's book and the movie, right? Here's Alice, and I got a picture up on the overhead. You remember the Cheshire Cat, right? Big smile, and his face is all crazy, eyes are all weird and all that kind of stuff. And he shows up, and Alice is at a junction. And she says to the Cheshire Cat, "Would you tell me, please, which way I ought to go from here?" "That depends a good deal on where you want to go," said the cat. "I don't much care where," replied Alice. Now listen to the cat's response. "Then it doesn't matter which way you go." See, if you want to go nowhere and just float through the lazy river of life, you can do that. You can have an aimless life where there's no direction. But if you delight yourself in the Lord, then it will start to change your desires. And as you find those godly desires rising up on the inside of you, then that will determine your direction. You will see, if I'm going to please God, if I'm going to do what God wants me to do, then I need to go here. I need to do this. I need to look that. See, once there's a desire, there will be a destination. If I know, man, I love surfing, then I better be going to the ocean, right? If I love sports, then I'm going to the sports complex. But if I love Jesus, come on, somebody. Then I know where I'm going. I'm going to church. I'm going to the Word. I'm going to the prayer closet. I'm going to the streets to tell someone about Jesus. I know where I'm going because I have a desire on the inside of me. Let's take a look at it in the Word. Back to the Old Testament in 2 Chronicles, okay? 2 Chronicles chapter number 17 talks about a guy. You know him by the name of Jehoshaphat, right? Kind of a funny name. Some of you guys might have heard of Jumpin' Jehoshaphat. I don't think he's the same guy because I never saw him jumping in the Bible. Thank you for those laughs. First service didn't laugh. They're all stuffy. I like you guys. Look at what it says in 2 Chronicles. Let me get to the right Chronicles here. I'm in first. Okay, 2 Chronicles chapter 17. 2 Chronicles chapter 17 and verse, look at this, number 6. talking about Jehoshaphat. Look, it says, and his heart took delight in the ways of the Lord. So now, what did we learn already? We learned that your delight determines your desires. Your desires determine your direction. Let's see if the principle applies to Jehoshaphat. His heart took delight in the ways of the Lord. So now we know that because he's delighting in the ways of the Lord, he has a godly desire. Did that determine his direction? Read the rest of the verse. Moreover, he removed the high places and wooden images from Judah. See, because he took a delight in the ways of the Lord, it started to change his desires. And his desire was that people would serve the living and true God. His desire was that people would not be deceived and bow down before idols. And so now, because of that desire, it determined his direction. He knew that if that was going to take place, that he had to remove those high places. He had to take down those wooden images. And he had to raise up a standard of righteousness for the nation. Now, you can read through the rest of the life of Jehoshaphat, and he didn't do everything right. He married into a wicked family. He aligned himself with the wrong people. And yet you will find all the time, even when he's going out to battle with the wrong guy at his side, he says, "What is the word of the Lord?" He was seeking God throughout his life. And there was a time where three different armies surrounded him and came against him. And he went for the things of God, and he kept his desires with the Lord. And he asked God for what he should do. And God said, "Don't you worry about a thing. The battle belongs to the Lord." Wow. See, Jehoshaphat modeled this for us. He put the praisers out in front then. He said, "Well, if God's got it, then I'm going to praise him in advance for it." And so he organized his armies. But he said, put the praisers out in front. They praised God on the way out. While they were praising, God had an ambush going. The three armies wiped all of each other out. And when they came up, everybody was dead. And they reaped the spoils of that war. And they plundered all three armies in one day. And they had to carry away the spoil in heaps. My goodness. See, what can God do for us when we start to delight ourselves in the Lord? And now, because we delight ourselves in the Lord, it changes our desires. And because we have a godly desire now, it determines our direction. Remember, there was a time when a buddy of mine and I, we started to desire to serve God. We had a spirit of holiness come over us, and we just started to say, "Man, what are we going to do?" And just the other day, I was reminded of it because one of my friend's little buddies, he's like a nephew to me. He calls me Uncle D, and he came. He jumped in my lap. He said, "Uncle D, did you really burn all your comic books?" Because to him, you know, he started watching the Avengers movies and all this kind of stuff that's out right now. And so to him, like, why would you burn that stuff? You know what I mean? But I know better because I read those things, and they're full of demons. They're full of pornography, all sorts of other stuff. Be careful, parents, okay, what you let your kids put in their eye gates, okay? Movies and that sort of thing are fun, but you watch what they're watching. You watch what they're reading, and you be the parent, and you raise up the standard of godliness for your home, okay? So I realized that if I was going to go to the next level with God, I had to get some things out of my life that had been a bondage for me. And so I went over, and he says, "Where did you burn them?" This little guy, you know, my little nephew, he says, "Where did you burn the comic books at?" And I said, "Well, it was in the church parking lot. We had a church, and my friend lived in the house that was on the church property." And I said, "Man, I got to get rid of these things. I'm just going to burn them. I'm not going to sell them so that someone else can go into this stuff, you know." And so we started burning them. He brought a little grill. And then after a while, that little grill got filled up with too much. And so he brought out another grill. And so we started using so that one. And then all of a sudden, he brought out a hibachi. I'm like, "How many things you got back there, man? Like, come on. This is ridiculous." And that same day, my buddy that was with me, he had music in his car that had explicit language on it. And he just started taking those CDs out of his CD case. Remember those big folders we used to have before MP3s and the phones and all that? So he had this big old fat case filled with all sorts of stuff. And he just started breaking CDs on my front doorstep, just breaking them all. And we took those pieces, we gathered them up. And at the time, I was interning at a church in Encinitas, California, and they had a big wall, and we took those pieces of those broken CDs, and we put them all together in a mosaic tile in the form of a cross. It was so cool. I remember one of the students came in, and he was looking at it, and as he's looking at all the CDs and the cross, he says, "That's a good CD. Why would anyone break that CD?" I was able to share with him, "Listen, man, my delight is in the Lord. It's no longer in the things of this world. And because of my delight, now it's changed my desires. I don't desire that stuff anymore. That's not alluring to me. I don't take pleasure in that anymore. And because of that desire in my heart, it changed my direction, gave me a new destination, and now I'm going for the things of God. Which brings us to the last thing for today, which is this, that our godly aim brings God's pleasure. How many of you want to put a smile on God's face? I know I do. I mean, each and every one of us that calls ourselves a Christian, that should be a goal each and every day when we wake up, is that, God, I want to bring you pleasure with my life. It starts with the delight in the Lord, goes to our desires, determines our destination. And when we set our course, we set our face to serve the Lord now, our godly aim brings God's pleasure. Let me show it to you back to the Psalms this time. Psalm chapter 1, turn there with me in Psalm number 1, right off the bat, book of Psalms. I pray this set of verses over my family every night. Psalm 1, verse number 1 through verse number 3. Look at what it says. It starts out with one great, wonderful, powerful word. It says this. It says, blessed. Everybody say blessed. Blessed. Oh, come on. Say it loud like you mean. Say blessed. Blessed. Blessed is the man who walks not. In other words, their direction is not going like this. Who walks not in the counsel of the ungodly, nor stands in the path of sinners, nor sits in the seat of the scornful. Verse number 2, but his delight, oh, look at that. Now there's something different about this man who's blessed. His delight is where? Is in the law of the Lord. And in his law, he meditates day and night. See, his desire now has determined his direction. Now, because of his direction, because he has a godly aim, what does God do? Look at the next verse, verse number 3. He shall be. Everybody say, he shall be. That's the godly man. Now remember, when it talks about that, it could be man or woman. Okay, ladies, you are not excused from this because now in Christ there is no longer slave nor free, male nor female, right? It's all kingdom and now we're all sons of God. Okay, ladies say, well, that's not fair. I'm a daughter. Yes, you are a daughter, but guess what? I'm the bride of Christ too, okay? So you can be a son. It's all good, all right? He shall be like a tree. Oh, come on now. Planted by the rivers of water, that brings forth its fruit in season, whose leaf also shall not wither. Look at the last part of the verse. And whatever. Everybody say whatever.
Whatever.
Oh, come on. Say it with a little bit of attitude. Whatever.
Whatever.
And whatever he does, he shall prosper. Oh, my goodness. That's the life I want to live. Yeah. Amen. You know what whatever means, right? In case you didn't know, whatever means whatever. See, while we're here on the earth, yes, we're just passing through, but there's stuff we got to do. I still got to be a dad. I still got to be a husband. You still have to be a wife. You still have to be a spouse. You still have to be an employee. You still have to be a businessman or woman. You still have to be a witness in the community. You still have to be what you have to be. You have to be a grandma or a grandpa. Or you have to be, somebody who's a volunteer. You still have to do stuff. But if your aim is to please God, your delight has determined your desire determined your destination, and now while you're on your way, passing through as a pilgrim and as a soldier, as you please the Lord, his delight is now in you, and now you are blessed, and whatever you do, you shall prosper. Wow. Wow. As Christians, our death is a promotion. Life here is good, but our desire is set on something better. Why? Because we delight ourselves in the Lord. The philosopher Voltaire, who was an atheist, raged against God, messed a lot of people up, said these words. He says, I hate life, but I dread death. And that's the way it is with all people who have no hope. And yet it's very different for Christians. In stark contrast to Voltaire, Christmas Evans, when he was dying, he saw the chariot of God coming for him, to which he cried out and he shouted, drive on! And that should be our cry, is Lord, come. God, I'm aimed at heaven. God, I'm just passing through. God, I will be a steward of the things that you've given me, but God, I hold it loosely because it's all dirt and it's all gonna burn. Our delight is in him. Therefore, he is our desire. And because of our desire, it determines our direction. It determines the course of our life. No longer floating on a lazy river, but now passionate, purposeful, pursuing the things of God. And when we have a godly aim, It brings God's pleasure on our lives. We're seeking the homeland, desiring better. Did you guys get something from this series, from the word of the Lord today? Come on, hallelujah. Let's give the Lord a great big praise. Glory to God. You guys have been awesome today. I want to thank you guys for staying put. A bunch of people did get up and leave, but I got speakers in the foyer and down the breezeways. And so if you can hear my voice, listen up. God wants to speak to you too, right where you're at. I want to make sure before you guys leave this place that your destination is the right destination. I want to make sure that your heart is right with God, because if you left this place today and you died, or it was the last day on earth, I want to make sure that you head for heaven, to the homeland that God has prepared, and that you don't end up in hell. Now, sometimes people get offended when I use that term. They say, oh, preachers in hell. Why do they want to be mean? Why do they want to push us away? But think about it this way. What if you were standing in the street and I saw a big semi-truck coming straight at you? And I said, oh, there's a rolling thing coming in your direction that could potentially do you harm. You'd probably scratch your head and say, what? Right? And afterwards, you'd be mad at me. Why didn't you yell at me? Why didn't you tell me the truth? Why didn't you say, get out of the street, dummy? And yet, when preachers talk about hell, people get offended and say, why are you being mean to me? I'm not trying to be mean. I'm just letting you know there's something coming that you need to look out for. Hell is a very real place. God talks about it in the Bible, Old and New Testament. Jesus himself spoke about it. And it's terrible. It was never intended for you or for me. It was made for the devil and his angels who rebelled. And yet, God loves us enough to give us the free will choice while we're here on the earth of where we go, whether it's heaven or whether it's hell. Because just as real as hell is, heaven is a real place too. And I want to make sure that you go there. You want to make sure. And listen, most of all, God wanted to make sure. That's why he sent Jesus, beaten, bloody, hung on a cross, so that we didn't have to go to hell, but rather we could be with him forever and ever in heaven, in the homeland, in the city that God has prepared for us. But listen, you don't get there just by floating through life like we talked about. There has to be something that takes place. And so I want to pose a question to you today. I want you to answer the question in your heart. No one will know the answer but you and God. What if today was your last day? What makes you think you're going to heaven? Just answer that question in your heart quietly. You don't have to say it out loud. Just answer that. Examine yourself. The Bible says we should examine ourselves from time to time. Make sure that we're in the faith. What makes you think you're going to heaven? Now, sometimes people say, well, Pastor, all roads lead to heaven. You know, you do your thing, I'll do my thing. The church is out there. They can do whatever they want to do, and we'll all make it to whatever heaven we think of some way or another. But can I tell you something? Let's apply that logic to the earth for a second. What if I told you, you want to go to the moon? Just drive around. All roads lead to the moon. You'd say, Pastor, you're crazy. You can drive around the earth as long as you want, and you'll never make it to the moon. So if we understand that in the natural, why when we apply it to spiritual things, do we think that that logic still works? Oh, just do whatever you want to do, and we'll all make it to heaven somehow, some way. No. Don't you think God, the creator of the heavens and the earth, the one who wrote the plan of redemption, carried it out in his son Jesus, beaten, bloody, and hung on a cross. Don't you think after he does all that he would share with us how to get to heaven? Well, he does right here in his word. Jesus said, I'm the way, the truth, and the life. No man goes to the Father except by me. You know what that means? That means that it's God's heaven, and we're going to have to get there God's way. Can't get there your way. Can't get there my way. Can't get there some well-meaning church committee's way. We've got to get there God's way. Now, sometimes people say, well, Pastor, that's good news because I know that God lets good people into heaven. You know, I've been a really good person. Yeah, I used to be bad, but I cleaned up my act. Now, I've been really good lately. And in fact, I think I finally crossed over. You know, my good finally outweighs my bad. I've been working on my resume, doing a lot of good deeds, giving money to charities, getting involved in social justice causes, bought some shoes that get kids in Africa some shoes, drinking water that digs wells in third world countries. I've been really good, Pastor. Doesn't that mean that I get to go to heaven? Well, you know what the Bible says about being good? It says that if we're trying to get to heaven based on our goodness, that it's like filthy rags to God. It's going to get thrown out. The Bible tells us that all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. You can't make it to heaven based on your goodness because the standard is perfection. And the only one who is perfect, his name is Jesus. Not going to make it based on your own merit. Sometimes people say, well, Pastor, I understand that. I get that, but I was raised in church. My parents told me we were Christians growing up. We were born in America. America's a Christian nation. Everybody born in America is going to heaven. We're not any other religions. We're not Buddhist, Muslim, Hindus. Therefore, we're Christians. And they hang a cross or St. Christopher around your neck. Have you baptized or christened as a child? Take you to religious classes like Sunday school or catechism class, maybe Sabbath school class. And you think because you were raised in church, you're going to get to go to heaven. Can I tell you the truth today and not play games? Check it out in the Bible. Nowhere does it say you're raised in church that makes you a Christian. No, the Bible says your parents tell you're a Christian, or because you're wearing religious jewelry, attending religious classes, being baptized or christened as a child, or being born in America, that you get to go to heaven. It doesn't work like that. And I don't see anywhere in the Bible that God looks at your life and because you're not some other religion, that by default, he lumps you into the category of being a Christian, headed for heaven, and denying your presence in hell. It simply doesn't work like that. Today, let me love you enough to tell you the truth. You're not going to make it. Somebody in this place said, well, Pastor, hold on a second, because, you know, not only when I was a child did I go to church, here I am sitting in church in front of you right now, and I consider myself to be a Christian. Now, once again, let's apply that logic here on the earth. What if I said, you know what, I really want to be a fish, and I decided to be a fish, and so I went and I sat in the Pacific Ocean in the water, and I said, I'm a fish, I am a fish. Does that make me a fish? No. Eventually, I'd just be a slimy, pruny human sitting there in the water, right? So what makes us think we can just sit in church service, call ourselves a Christian, give ourselves a name or a title, and that makes us a Christian headed for heaven? See, it doesn't work like that. You say, but Pastor, you don't understand. My last church, I got involved. I didn't just sit. I got involved. I helped out. I sang in the choir, carried the pastor's Bible, made decisions in that church. People thought of me as a leader. I even taught in the Bible class, got a membership card to that church that I could show you. Well, that's great, and I'm glad you did those things. Just show that to me in the Bible, your volunteerism. God's not logging hours. God's not looking for your membership card to a church before you can enter the gates of heaven. That's not going to make it. You say, but Pastor, I know God. Someone told me that if I knew God, I'm a Christian. I know Jesus. I know about Christmas and sing the songs every year of my life. I celebrate the resurrection at Easter. I could quote scriptures to you, Pastor. Doesn't that mean that I'm a Christian? Well, if you'd read your Bible, you know the demons believe that Jesus Christ is the Son of God. They're not Christians. The devil himself knows who Jesus is and can quote scriptures out of his mouth. You can read that in your Bible. And yet that doesn't qualify him for heaven. So everybody look up here at me for a second. Look up here. This is not about what you have in your head. Not about having mental assent towards God. Knowing who Jesus is, and that gets you right with God, headed for heaven. Rather, this is about your heart. Today, here's the real question. Have you given God all of your heart? Have you given God all of your life? Because if not, I love you enough to tell you the truth, you're not going to make it. Jesus said it like this. He said, if you want to enter the kingdom of heaven, you must be born again. Now, I know. We use that term born again and people turn off. Ugh, I saw that in a movie. Yuck, I saw that in a blog on the internet or read about it in a magazine and saw a television show where people were talking about being born again. And just, it looked weird and I don't want to have any part of that. But let's not let society, movies, Hollywood, television, books, and the internet define for us what being born again means. Let's let the Bible do that, shall we? What does being born again really mean from the Bible? Well, from the beginning of the Bible to the end of the Bible, it's always meant the same thing. It means that you've given God all of your heart, and you've given God all of your life. Just that simple. It's all or nothing with Jesus. Let me prove it to you. Last book of the Bible, book of Revelation. Jesus is speaking to the church, just like he's speaking to us here in this church today. And he says, when I come, I want to find you hot, or I want to find you cold, because if I find you lukewarm, I will vomit you from my mouth. Now, those are pretty gross and graphic words from the mouth of Jesus, but what's he saying? Lukewarm, what's that all about? Well, it's little in, little out, little up, little down, little token prayer every now and again, an occasional church attendance. God is something in your life, but he's not everything, and you're not opposed to God, but you're not wholehearted for God. Listen, if that's your relationship with God, you're not going to make it. How do I know that? Because only people that are not real Christians will be ejected and rejected from the body of Christ. What's Jesus saying? He's saying in or out. Either you are or you aren't, but don't play games and think that you're going to make it because you did a little penance every now and then and had a little something of God in you. No, it's all or nothing with Jesus. Today, I'm going to give you an opportunity. Jesus said these words. He said, if you confess me before men, I'll confess you before my Father. But if you deny me, I will deny you. Today, your call, your choice. Here's how the opportunity is going to look. In a moment, I'm going to count to three. One, two, three. And when I say three, I'm going to pop my hands together. Bang. When you hear the sound of my hands popping together, bang, that's your opportunity to raise your hand. What you're doing by the raising of your hand is you're saying, I want to give God all my heart. I want to give God all my life. I want to be born again, headed for heaven, denying my presence in hell. I'll see your hand go up. I'll count it. You can put it right back down. Now you might be thinking, whoa, 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 wait a second. Time out. If I raise my hand, I'll be embarrassed. Mm-hmm. You might be. That's okay. Let's push past that today. Because think of the trade-off. Isn't it better to be embarrassed for a moment than to end up in hell forever and ever and ever? And no one would make that trade. You say, Pastor, I feel like you're pushing me. I am. You know why? Because the devil's on the other side pushing just as hard. When he lets up, I'll let up. But I ain't letting up. Because I love you enough to tell you the truth today. God loves you so much, he sent Jesus, beaten, bloody, hung on a cross. Now, will you make the change, make the choice, and say yes to Jesus by simply raising your hand? Probably won't even be embarrassed, but even if you are, better than ended up apart from God forever and ever. Who should raise their hand in a moment? If you've been running from God instead of to God, I'm speaking to you. Who should raise their hand if you're not sure about your salvation? Today is your day, make sure. Who should raise their hand if you've never done this, never said yes to Jesus, given him all of your heart and all of your life? I'm speaking to you. Or finally, who should raise their hand if you know that you're lukewarm? When I described that, you said, that's me. Hey, come on, get ready to say, I'm in. I'm all in for Jesus today by simply raising your hand in a moment. All across this auditorium, back in the family rooms, wherever you're at, watching by television in the foyer, down at the Love Rock Cafe, come on, if you're on campus, you can raise your hand right where you're at and then come back into the church service or telling us you're right afterwards. Online, wherever you're watching, all over the world, you can raise your hand and God sees you right where you're at right now. And then afterwards, you can minimize your video screen and click the blue button that says respond to God, or go to our homepage, rockchurch.com, and find the tab that says how to know God, and someone will lead you in a prayer. I'm going to count to three. Pop my hands together. This is your time. This is your moment of salvation. Here we go. If you need to do this, get ready to get your hand up. Here we go. One, two, three. Let me see your hands. Just raise them up high for me. There's one, two, three, four, five, six, seven, eight. Thank you. Nine, 10. Got you over there. 10 wise people. 11. Thank you. Up on top. Give me a little wave if I can't see. 12. Got you up there. Thank you. 13 up over there. On this side. On this side. What, all the sinners sat on this? Okay, I got you. 13, 14, okay. Cool. Anybody else? I don't want to say I'm a sinner. Listen, come on. We're all ex-somethings in this place. And so I didn't embarrass them, and I won't embarrass you. 14 wise people, 15, got you up there. 16 back in the family room. Thank you. God bless you. Who else today? 16 wise people already. Is there anybody else you're saying, man, I know I need to do this. I know I should, but I just, Come on, if you're struggling, you're wrestling right now. There's two more over there. Got you guys. 18 wise people. Who else today? 18 wise people. Come on, number 19. That's you. You're sitting there wondering if you should. 19 up on top. Oh, can't you just feel number 20? Where's number 20 up there? Got you, number 20. Thank you. God bless you. Say, is he wrapping it up? No, I'm a greedy little preacher today. Come on, who else? Who else? Got 20 wise people already. 21 up on top. Got you up there. Thank you. God bless you. 21 wise people. Anybody else real quick that I didn't already see, but you know you need to do this? Come on. Just lift your hand up high. Anybody else? Anybody else? All right. Let's give the Lord a great big praise for 21 wise people today. Hallelujah. Oh, so cool. So good. So good. I'm excited for you guys. Now listen, we want to help you in your new walk with God. You don't get saved just by raising your hand. You got to invite Jesus into your heart. He's a gentleman. He comes in when you invite him, okay? So today we want to change destinies with you. Can't do that till we get you down here. So in a moment, here's what we're going to do. We're all going to stand, give you a clap and give you a shout, all right? That's your cue. Get your stuff. Whatever you brought with you to church, coat, purse, sweater, Bible, a friend if you need a friend. Say, come on, friend. I'll go with you if you need to. If you stand next to somebody and they raise their hand, say, come on, friend. Let's go. All right? And get in the aisle. Meet me up front because we're going to change destinies today. Now, listen, if you raised your hand, cool. If your children raise their hand, bring them. They're welcome at this time. If you didn't raise your hand, come on. You can come too. All right? Let's all stand and welcome them. And you come right now. Just make your way to the front if that's you. Come on down. Come on down.
I surrender all.
They're coming. Let's give them a hand as they come.
And I surrender.
You can come too. This is your time. This is your moment of salvation.
And unto thee my blessing. Savior, I
Hallelujah, they're coming. They're coming.
And I surrender.
In the foyer, if you raise your hand out there, come on in. This is your time right now. Come on down.
I surrender all.
Come on, you can come too. This is your time. This is your moment.
Unto thee, my blessed Savior.
Anybody else, if you need to come?
I surrender.
Come on, they're still coming. They're still coming. You can come too.
And I surrender.
Man, you guys look so good up here. Put a big smile on your face. This is a good thing. This is not a bad thing, okay? Came to give God all of your heart. Came to give God all of your life. Best decision of your life right here, right now. That's awesome. You can put a smile on your face and be happy about that. Okay, I want to introduce you guys to a friend of mine right over here to my right, your left. This is Pastor Joel. He's a really good guy. Nothing weird goes on. You know, sometimes you go to church, you wonder, are they weird? You already got past me, okay? I'm about as weird as it gets today, okay? He's cool. He's going to do three things with you. I'm going to let you know what they are in advance. You're not wondering or concerned, okay? He's going to pray with you. Simple prayer to invite Jesus into your heart. You're going to be born again, like we talked about. Secondly, he's going to give you some free information, some free literature to read about. Now that I'm a Christian, what do I do next, okay? It's easy reading. It's free. And you get a hold of that, I'm going to give you a hint, okay? Get back to church. It'll help you to grow in your walk with God. And then finally, he's going to introduce you to a program we have here called Spiritual Personal Trainers. He'll describe how it works, and then he'll let you come right back out, and your friends and family will wait for you. Now, you might be thinking, okay, wait a second. Spiritual Personal what? Spiritual Personal Trainers. Let me break it down to you like this. It's a friend in church who will help you to get strong in the ways of the Lord so you don't have the wrong delight, the wrong desires, and the wrong destination, but that they get you on course to the homeland like we talked about today. You go on with God, getting strong and healthy in the ways of the Lord. Okay? He'll describe how that works. It's easy, it's free, and you need to do it. And listen, if you guys consistently sit under the teaching of the rock here, give us a year, you know? Sit consistently, faithfully, getting the word of God in your heart, getting your desire and your direction with God and feeling the pleasure of God. At the end of that year, you will look around your life and say, oh my goodness, I am so blessed. I didn't know it could be like this. Am I telling the truth, everybody? Take their word for it, okay? You guys make a left turn, follow Pastor Joel right this way. Let's give them a hand as they go. Hallelujah.
Hey, you just heard that altar call. You just wanted to give God all of your heart and all of your life. Now let me lead you simply in a prayer of inviting Jesus Christ into your heart as your Lord and Savior. In fact, why don't you just go ahead and listen to me and go ahead and close your eyes and just repeat these words after me. I'll go slow, you repeat them. Say these words. Say, Father God, I come to you in the name of Jesus. I believe that Jesus Christ is your only begotten Son and that you sent him for me. And then he died for me on that cross at Calvary. I believe that his blood washes away my sins, that I am now a new creature in Christ Jesus. And I thank you, Lord. I receive you now and forever as my Lord and as my Savior. I'm going to turn from sin, and I'm going to turn with all of my heart and all of my life to you, Jesus, as my Lord and as my Savior. Let it be known in heaven, as well as upon the earth, that I am born again. I'm a child of God, that I'm saved, and I'm headed for heaven and denying my presence in hell. Thank you, Jesus. I'm alive forevermore. Love you so much. God bless you guys. Everybody just say amen and receive Christ as your Lord and Savior. So talk to you later. God bless you.
Thank you for listening to the Rock Church and World Outreach Center. If this message spoke to you, please share it with us. We'd love to hear from you. You can find more information at www.rockchurch.com.